Today on MarcusNews.com, do you eat right but still have a weight problem? It could be your thyroid or liver. Find out how to test your thyroid yourself and what to do about it. Learn how to clean your liver at home naturally. Also, why too much iodine can be dangerous and even deadly. Today's guest is medical expert James Sloane. Change your life right now. I talk like this because I can, and it's fun.
I guess the big issue with most people is weight. Yeah. I know some people that are raw foodists, that exercise, that don't have any unnatural substance at all, and they have weight issues. It could be thyroid.
Well, when people come to me and they're talking about a weight issue, saying they want to lose weight, first thing I always have them do is check their basal body temperature, make sure it's not the thyroid. I don't even care if they went to the doctor and they had the lab test done, because again, lab tests are notoriously inaccurate when it comes to thyroid testing. First of all, so if you're under stress, you have a higher metabolic demand, thyroid hormones go up. So let's say this is normal, you're down here, but you're going to the doctor and you're fighting traffic and all that stress starts raising it. Then you get to the doctor thinking about the bill and everything else you want to do, and then you go stick with a needle. It's like, yeah, it's up here. So then they read it and say, oh, see, you're way up here and you're normal. Right. And then you get back home and you know, back here. So that's one reason. The second reason that the tests often miss hypothyroidism is there's another hormone called RT3, stands for reverse triiodothyronine. And RT3 is structurally similar to T3, which is the most biologically active hormone, but RT3 is biologically inactive. So what happens if you have high RT3 levels, it locks up your T3 receptors. So even though you have T3, you can't utilize it. Same way like type 2 diabetics produce more than enough insulin, they can't utilize their own insulin. So you can have normal TSH, T3, and T4, you can still be hypothyroid. So the lab tests are not the way to go. If you suspect hypothyroidism, like you have the dry hair, dry skin, hair falling out, fatigue, and so on, you want to do what's called basal body temperature. Get a glass thermometer, and they do have mercury-free thermometers. You can get them pretty much anywhere anymore. Go to the pharmacy section, and they're basal thermometers. And you want to take that, keep it beside your bed, shake it down, keep it on your nightstand. As soon as you wake up in the morning, don't get up, start walking around or anything. Just grab the thermometer. You want to put it under your arm. And you want to hold it there for about 10 minutes, and you want to jot down the temperature. Now, if you get up and you go to the bathroom or whatever first, your muscle temperature is going to raise, your body temperature, throw it off. So make sure you don't get up first. Just lay there, grab the thermometer under the arm, 10 minutes, jot it down. You do that every day, preferably at least a week. Women even longer, if you can do 2 weeks, even better. You average out that temperature, and that will tell you where your thyroid's at. You should be running 97.6 or higher as an average. If you're running like 94, 95, 96, you're going to be hypo. Yeah, especially if you have the symptoms, you know, the dry hair, dry skin, hair falling out, fatigue, depression.
If you have low body temperature when you wake up, well, but what if the room's cold or...
Most people aren't going to, you know, stay... Your body temperature should compensate anyway.
What if you're skinny and you're just...
Well, if you're skinny, you can still be hypothyroid, so it's...
No, I'm saying, like, your body temperature's low because you have no fat on your body, and it's a cold room, it's wintertime. I mean, can that interfere with the...
Generally, no, because your body temperature is still going to compensate, and that's why you're holding it there for 10 minutes, because if your arm's against your body like that, the thermometer's insulated enough that you still should have a pretty accurate reading underneath.
And a digital thermometer would work okay?
I don't like the digitals because a lot of them don't go below 97. And if your ring said 95, 96, it's not going to register.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So they don't register low, just high?
Yeah, a lot of them don't, yeah. Some might, but most of them I've seen will not go below 97.
And you can still get the old school kind?
Yeah, they're mercury-free now, but...
What do they use?
I think it's just probably alcohol and red dye. Like, you know, used to go to Fisherman's Wharf, and they'd have those little red thermometer. Yeah. But it's probably something like that.
Okay, so let's say you test and you got really low body temperature in the mornings.
Yeah, then you know it's... And with the symptoms, it would be... hypothyroidism.
What's your first line of thinking in that case?
The reason for doing the basal body temperature first is it's going to either confirm that there's hypothyroidism or it's going to rule it out, and so now you can look at the other possible causes, because there's not a singular cause for weight gain. There's a lot of reasons for weight gain. And so it's not something that people always have control, because, you know, a lot of people will think, well, if that person's heavy, they must just overeat, and they don't exercise. No, that's not always the case. There's children with Prader-Willi syndrome where they have a hypothalamic defect where they never get the signal telling them that they're full, and you literally have to chain the refrigerator shut because they can eat themselves to death. Because they'll eat and eat and eat because they never get that signal from the stomach center saying, hey, I'm full. Right. And so that's one possibility. There's women going on estrogen replacement therapy, especially Premarin. Premarin is 3,000 times stronger than the body's own estrogen, and estrogen causes the fat cells to enlarge. So that's another, diabetes can cause it. Hypothalamic pituitary dysfunction. There's Yeah, the overeating, lack of exercise are, of course, ones too. But you know, again, there's multiple reasons for weight gain. It's not a simple, you know, this is it in all cases. So you want to rule the thyroid out first. If it shows hypothyroidism, then okay, now we're going to treat for hypothyroidism. If the hypothyroidism is out, then okay, now we look at, okay, could be this, could be this, could be this.
And so let's say it's hypothyroidism. Let's say your body temperature is low in the mornings. What would be your first thing to do?
Well, actually, I use my thyroid tonic, but the thing with hypothyroidism too, again, there's not a single cause of hypothyroidism. It can be hypothalamic pituitary dysfunction, chronic stress, high RT3, poor T4, T3 conversion, a lack of iodine, Hashimoto's thyroidosis, which is autoimmune. So there's, you know, all these various causes of hypothyroidism. So you have to kind of address the various causes unless you know absolutely 100% that it's caused from this, and we can specifically address that. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you want to kind of cover the gamut. So, of course, there is iodine. You just want to make sure you don't take it in high doses. Nothing over 1 milligram a day. Because I've seen people recommending anywhere from 50 to 300 milligrams in a day, which is absolutely ridiculous, because toxicity with iodine can start at 1 milligram.
There is this detoxified iodine that you can get.
How's that for what?
Is that something that you would say is okay?
Or? Yeah, this could be used.
But where do you normally get your iodine?
I like seaweeds myself. I mean, some people are kind of against the seaweeds for various reasons. They try to claim it's full of heavy metals, not realizing that the algae in there bind the heavy metals so they can't be absorbed by the body. Now with, you know, Fukushima, everyone's really concerned about iodine sources out there from seaweed. Still, I prefer, you know, seaweeds as my primary iodine source. I also like black walnut hull. It is actually quite high. Some people argue, no, it's not that high because it's only like, you know, 15 milligrams per 100 grams, and but that's for what the body requires, right. That's a very high.
Let's kill parasites while you're at it.
Exactly. So
seaweed was what the Japanese used for radiation therapy back when they were bombed.
Right.
You know, if they dropped atomic bombs in Japan, and their seaweed was probably radioactive. But they took the seaweed anyway, and it helped them survive.
Again, the metals that are in there that are radioactive are going to be bound to the sodium alginate, and it's going to be pulled out of the body regardless. I'd find it hard to believe that most of the seaweed's that radioactive in the first place for a couple of reasons. One, you're talking about very heavy isotopes, and they should be sinking in the water. I mean, the floor of the ocean's probably going to be real radioactive by now because those isotopes, again, are heavy. They're going to sink. But algae, in order to grow, requires sunlight. So it doesn't grow in the deeper oceans, it grows up in the shallower. Mm-hmm. And so most of the radioactive isotopes should have sunk anyways. So I'm not 100% convinced that the seaweed's radioactive to begin with. And the other thing is when we get herbs and stuff, people don't realize that herbs are more heavily tested than pharmaceutical drugs. When you get herbs, they have to be tested by the original harvester, and they gotta be tested again by the importer, they gotta be tested again by the raw material supplier, they gotta get tested again by the wholesaler, they gotta get tested twice by the manufacturer, both when they first get it, and then it's gotta be tested again in the final product. And part of that is to test for metals, which would include radioactive metals. So if they're really radioactive, as people are trying to claim, they wouldn't pass all these tests. So I'm not really buying into the whole, you know, the seaweed's radioactive and, you know, it's at least not in levels that would be harmful.
So, okay, let's get back to the thyroid thing. What would be some things to do?
Okay, of course, again, iodine being one, just gotta, again, really watch your dosage because you don't want to exceed, well, 1 milligram is the absolute high end level because you, iodine has a very strong half-life in the body. It's like 50-something days, I think 54 days or something like that, half-life in the body. So it's very long-lasting in the body. We don't need to take megadoses day after day after day like a lot of people do. Like I said, I have seen people, you know, recommend anywhere from 50 to 300 milligrams a day. And then when people are reporting side effects from those high levels, they're giving people the story about, oh, you're just detoxing bromine, which is total BS. It has nothing to do with that. First of all, bromine has a very short half-life in the body. It's only a couple of days, so it's out of your system very quick. And if you think about how much like salt we consume, salt is sodium chloride. You got the chlorine as a halogen displaces bromine. So there's not going to be a buildup of bromine in the system in the first place. The side effects these people are getting are from the iodine itself. And so they're telling people, you know, first of all, you're having a bromine detox. So they tell you to take a salt flush, saying that the salt will get rid of the bromine, but the salt's also getting rid of the iodine. So what it's doing is you're getting rid of all excess iodine that's poisoning you in the first place. And then they're turning around telling people not to take more iodine. It's like, no, don't do that. I had a friend of mine die a little over a year ago from iodine. He was on a drug called amiodarone, which is 75 milligrams iodine per tablet. And he ended up developing such severe hypothyroidism from iodine poisoning that he was falling. So I was there all the time to make sure that if he fell, I could get him up and all this. And we talked to the cardiologist, and he agreed it was the iodine causing the problem. So he wants to get him off the amiodarone. So we spent 4 months getting him off of it. He went through all the hypothyroid, side effects, including hallucinations, insomnia, fatigue, weakness, all that. Got him off of it. He went back to normal. Mind was clear, able to walk. He wasn't falling anymore. Then, long story short, he ended up in the hospital. His primary doctor put him back on amiodarone at double the dosage and killed him. He ended up with such severe hypothyroidism that we were putting spoonfuls of water in his mouth. He couldn't even swallow that because his hypothyroidism was so severe from the excess iodine. So that's why I'm not big on high dose iodine. Yes, iodine is essential to the body, but it's required in trace amounts. That's why it's called a trace element. Mm-hmm. It's not a megadose element, it's a trace element. So no more than 1 milligram iodine per day, which the iodine you're showing me, the detoxified iodine, is great because it's only 200 microgram per drop. So
what about goitrogenic foods?
Oh, it's really funny. It goes back to what we were talking earlier about phytoestrogens, and phytoestrogens are found in every single plant that we consume, but phytoestrogens are goitrogenic. So
every plant out there is a goitrogen, basically.
Technically, yeah. It's just varying levels of phytoestrogens. Yeah. So they got varying levels of goitrogenic activity. But iodine counters the goitrogenic effects of the plants. So it's like, if you look in Asian countries, again, they eat a lot of soy, which everybody, claims, oh, it's goitrogenic, it's going to knock your thyroid out. But they also eat foods that have seaweed.
Fish.
Exactly.
Yeah, they
that have iodine.
There are people that take iodine and still have weight problems. And so it's something beyond that. And I say, well, okay, well, you keep looking for a magic pill to take, something to take to get rid of the problem. Have you ever considered what's causing the problem in the first place? What's wiping out your thyroid? What are things that wipe out your thyroid?
High estrogen, that's a big one. Again, look at how many estrogens we're exposed to, whether it be your own estrogen or environmental estrogen.
Plastic bottles you're drinking.
Mm-hmm. Dioxin, DDT, all these things. DDT has been banned for how many years, but what people don't realize is that DDT takes 100 years to break down in the soil. It's still there. It didn't magically go away.
So cleaning out your liver and your cleansing, your detoxing system should be a priority, right? So if your body's toxic, your thyroid is going to get knocked out. So you got to clean out your liver, your colon.
Yeah, the biggest regulator for estrogen in the body or estrogenic compounds is the liver. And the liver uses a process known as methylation, again, in order to break down the extra estrogens in the body. So the primary thing you want to focus on if you're trying to regulate your hormones, which again can affect your thyroid inadvertently, would be to work on your liver. I'm not talking about liver flushes. Those are bogus. Those do not work. What you want to do is, the best way to cleanse your liver is to use digestive bitters. And these are, anything bitter tasting will really do the trick. I mean, this goes way back to the 17th century, whatever. They had the digestive bitters for after dinner drinks, like Angostura bitters is where that came from. And they'd eat these real heavy meals, lots of protein, lots of fat, and they're very hard to digest. So you get indigestion after these big, hard to digest meals. And so they would have an after dinner drink of these digestive bitters. And when you drink it, it hits the bitter receptors back here in the back of the tongue, stimulates a nerve called the vagus nerve. That's VAGUS. Now the vagus nerve branches off, does various things to the body, but it, among other things, it affects the stomach, so it will increase your stomach acid levels, it increases your pancreatic enzyme output, and it stimulates the gallbladder, so it helps to release that bile and get more bile coming in. It also has a cleansing effect on the liver and also on the intestines. So overall, they're great. You just have to get used to the taste.
It's funny that nowadays, after a meal, we have sugar. We have dessert. It's the exact opposite, right? What does sugar do? Putrefies and ferments food you just ate. It knocks out
your immune system.
Yeah, it's just funny. So dandelions, anything that's bitter, right? Like watercress.
Dandelion greens are very good. The juniper berries are actually really good. And juniper berries also lower your blood sugar.
The dried ones are okay?
Yeah, I used to take them, and I would take a hammer, I'd smash them flat, and I would pop them and swallow them like a pill. And that was the easiest way to get them down, because if you chew on them, they're pretty nasty. I'll chew on juniper berries when I'm out collecting herbs, and if I see a juniper tree, I'll take them and I'll chew the fleshy coating off the outside and then spit the seed out and then just chew on the bitterness of the flesh itself. But those are good. Gentian, your wormwood, mugwort, all those in small amounts. Philanthus, picassia, and there's all sorts of bitter tasting herbs out there, and you don't need large amounts, because they do sell what's called digestive bitters on the market, and there's various brands out there, but most of them have compounds I don't really care for. Like, they'll have either stimulant laxatives like Ascaris sagrada, senna, rhubarb root. Those are all stimulant laxatives. They cause a laxative dependence after a couple weeks of use, and I don't like the bearberry herbs like golden seal, barberry, Oregon grapefruit, because among other things, they destroy your intestinal flora. They deplete your potassium, they can damage the intestinal lining. I'm not really big on those. So if you do have any of the bitters with those compounds in there, like Swedish bitters, for example, you want to only take very small amounts, because, again, it's not something where you're doing a chemical reaction per se in the body, so you don't need a large amount. You're doing a nerve stimulation. So in order,
how long does it need to be on your tongue?
Oh, just instantly. You just take half a drop or full of the bitters, squirt it on your tongue, and swallow. And you swallow, you go, and then it does the trick.
That's it. So you don't have to have it sit on your tongue for a while. You just...
No, you'll definitely taste it when you go to swallow, because say your bitter receptors are back here, so when you go to swallow it, it goes over those bitter receptors.
Basically, a little bit of water, just like an ounce or two, with something bitter in it, and you just drink it.
Yeah.
You don't need to like have it sit on your tongue or...
Yeah, I just squirt them directly on my tongue, you know, say about half a drop or full, squirt on my tongue and swallow. And or so you can chew on, if you want to avoid the alcohol, you can get a bitter tasting herb like a little bit of gentian or something, and you just take a pinch and you put it on your tongue and just suck on it for, you know, 5-10 seconds, so it has a chance for the saliva to extract some of that bitterness, and then you go swallow, do the same trick.
Okay, so something bitter on your tongue, lecithin.
Yeah, fat emulsifier, it helps to get rid of fats that are, I mean, stored up. Like, you got fatty liver, it actually is good for that. It's funny because when I was real little, we had a doctor here in town that we went to, and he was kind of half and half with, you know, holistic and allopathic, and so he kind of believed in things like that. And you know, he'd tell my mom and stuff, says, I would never eat liver, so that's the body's filter. You know, it's like,
yeah, I know, yeah.
It's the body's trying to get rid of that stuff.
Yeah,
it made sense. Plus, you know, it is super high in cholesterol.
Let's say you've got problems, and you say, man, I got to clean my liver. Right? Something serious happening here. Yeah, what's the fastest, best way to clean out your liver?
Definitely digestive bitters. And when you're using digestive bitters, you know, it's very, very important that you drink a lot of water throughout the day, because the
toxins being released.
But, yeah.
Okay, so how often, how many times a day do you do that, chugging something bitter?
Usually I have people start out with like once every couple of days, and then gradually work up to 3 times a day.
On an empty stomach?
It doesn't really matter. You can do either way. Usually I do empty stomach regardless, because most of the bitters will have the bearberry in there, and it turns your tongue bright yellow. So I do it before meals, so that, you know, when you eat, it gets rid of some of that yellow and stuff. But before or after, it doesn't really matter.
Okay.
Just make sure, you know, again, lots of water, because you want to help hyperdilute and flush that stuff out of your system. And you might want to start on a day when you don't plan to go to work, because you can get detox symptoms and you don't want to feel like, you know, crap at work and stuff. So pick a day when, you know, to start out when you're not going to be going to work or have some major function or something to go to.
So weight issues boils down to cleaning out your body, making sure if your thyroid, let's say your thyroid is messed up. Cleaning out your liver is probably the best thing you do for your thyroid.
That's one of the things you can do, yeah, because if the liver's not breaking down extra estrogens in your body, then it can definitely affect the thyroid. But thyroid can also be affected by other things too. Again, hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal dysfunction. And how many people are downing Red Bulls and stuff like that, crashing their adrenal glands, or smoking? All that crashes the adrenals. Well, the adrenals regulate your thyroid hormone production. One of the things I was going to mention too is with the iodine, that because a lot of people don't discuss the adverse effects of the iodine. I see all these recommendations about, oh, iodine's for every cell in the body and it's good for you. You got to take these massive doses. And
well, iodine is good for you, just a tiny bit though.
Yeah, it's like water. I mean, water's essential to the body, but I don't recommend drinking thousands of gallons a day if you could.
Drink.
Yeah, it would kill you. You actually get an electrolyte imbalance in the brain, it'll swell your brain and kill you very quick. And so that's what kind of what they're doing with the iodine. They said the recommended daily allowance for iodine, which of course is the minimum amount you require per day, is 150 microgram. But we're talking about people saying it's at 50 to 300 milligrams a day, which is thousands of times higher than what is a safe recommended dose. And that's where they're running into problems. And one of the other things I had found, I found a couple of studies where they actually found that excessive levels of iodine actually increase the risk of thyroid cancer. So a lot of people are using it to treat cancer, are claiming
or thyroid.
Yeah, and I've seen a lot of people claim that, oh, it's good for cancer, which kind of is true. You know, iodine is an estrogen antagonist, so it can work or help out with certain cancers that are estrogen dependent. And so in that way, yes, it would help with the cancers, but phytoestrogens do the same exact thing, and they're a whole lot safer than taking massive doses of iodine. And then, like I say, you do have the risk of actually increased risk of cancer, not only because of the toxicity to the thyroid with high doses of iodine, but when you suppress the thyroid, if you take massive doses of iodine, what happens, your thyroid first goes into hyperthyroidism, and then it goes into rebound hypothyroidism as the thyroid shuts down. Now, when you end up in the hypothyroid state, you end up producing high levels of what's called homocysteine. Homocysteine is pro-inflammatory and has been linked, among other things, to increased risk of cancer. So, you know, you got to, again, iodine, yes, it is essential, and yes, you do need it. I believe in it, but not in mega doses right. that are toxic.
So, like a drop of this.
Yeah, that's 200 micrograms per drop in that formula there.
Yeah.
And so that's good.
Yeah. That or seaweed.
Yeah. Yeah. Those are about the best sources, unless, you know, a little black walnut hull is good too. But yeah, just, but you don't need to say massive doses. Like I said, the half-life of iodine is roughly, I think it was 54 days. And so you don't need to take massive doses day after day after day, because it takes a long time for the body to get rid of iodine out of the system.
Okay.
If people want to read more on it, they go to my med capsule site and look up under, be under thyroid issues. And I got a thing on iodine safety on there, and it'll talk about the different, and I have some of the different studies on the cancer and stuff.
Because the older people get, the more thyroid becomes an issue to them.
Yeah, there's quite a few different reasons for that. Again, because like I said, hypothyroidism has so many different causes. It's not simply just a lack of iodine. Because a lot of people, again, they think, you know, if I have hypothyroidism, I'm lacking in iodine. You can have Hashimoto's thyroidosis, which is autoimmune, and taking high doses of iodine actually aggravates Hashimoto's thyroidosis. So it's not always just simply a lack of iodine. And even if you have sufficient iodine, there's a thing called cyclodensin monophosphate, or cyclocamp for short. Now, cyclic AMP, it helps the body to utilize the existing iodine. So if you're low in cyclic AMP production, you can have all the iodine in the world. Again, it's not going to do you any good, because you have to be able to actually utilize it. So it is a much more complicated issue than what they're trying to make it out, but simply taking iodine does not treat all forms of hypothyroidism.
Mm-hmm. Your body has to be working right for your body to work right. We can't like figure out every last little detail, but I guess the best thing is clean out your body and only put good stuff back in. And then your body will kind of figure out hopefully what to do from there, right? Because we could like troubleshoot forever trying to figure out what it is. But I guess most people are afraid to look at their lives. They're afraid to see that they're actually sneaking a candy bar and drinking some alcohol and Red Bull or you know, eating bread and pasta all day or whatever it is that they're doing that they know is not good for them, eating pizza. And then they're saying, well, what pill, what magic like substance do I take to get rid of this problem that I have? Well, maybe if you stop doing what caused it in the first place, instead of focusing on some magic thing to save you at the last second.
Yeah, it's like people who have lung cancer and they don't want to quit smoking.
Right.
You know, what's good going to do all these treatments and stuff? You're just going to keep smoking.
Yeah, I know. All right, thanks, James.
Yeah, thank you.
We're going to be back with you shortly with another James interview.